There's a storm coming to Lawrence, Kansas.
I think it's talked about the brand that we always talked about is we don't listen, we don't look around, we just got to put our nose down to the grindstone and go get it on.
They say,
water,
hey man,
let's get it one way on me, one way.
I know the score, at the back of my head. Break me down.
Sit back, relax, let's get loud, Cardinal Nation. It's time for the 2018 season, and Laron Fonseca is ready to do the honors. Fonseca steps up and lifts off.
Welcome to the good life. Welcome to the good life.
The wait is over.
Welcome to the good life.
After all the talk, all I gotta say is,
welcome to the good life.
You're welcome. You're all welcome. Like we always do at this time. I go for mine. I got to shine. Now throw your hands up in the sky.
And they'll counter it to Taylor. He snaps to the left, breaks to the 10, rushes to the 1, and he's in. An easy touchdown run for Dontrell Taylor. 15 yards to punctuate a 77-yard drive. It's 6-0 Nicholls, just like that. The linemen are stunting four-man pressure with 4K to deep bomb to the middle of the field. Jean-Pierre, a remarkable reception. He's tackled at the 20. Lights, camera, action. Damian Jean-Pierre, game number one of his senior season.
Fonseca to tie it. And he does. Kansas Nicholls out of Thibodaux, Louisiana, tied at 10.
Let's go, baby.
How do we do that?
Go!
Bender drops back, hit again. Evan Veron wrapping up and sacking Peyton Bender. Back-to-back sacks. 3 sacks in the last 2 series for the Colonels. It's 3rd and 2 for the Nicholls Colonels. Tie game, 3rd quarter in a Big 12 venue. And 4K play fake throws on a slant and hits Jean-Pierre for a first down on the beak of the Jayhawk at midfield. 13-yard pickup, first down Nicholls. Kansas trying to make some changes at their line. They don't have time, and the Colonels run it free right up the middle. It is over. Bussy, 10-5, end zone, 40 yards, touchdown Nicholls, 16-10 Colonels on a Kendall Bussy 40-yard score.
4.5 minutes to play. KU down 5. Bender has a man over the middle. That's Kurt Johnson. And that's Kurt Johnson for the touchdown.
Would you rather have but Laron Fonseca in this situation?
Nobody.
43-yard field goal to tie it. Wesley Barnett from Ocean Springs, Mississippi. Snap is solid. The ball is down, and Fonseca's kick, no doubt about it. We're tied at 20. 43-yarder effortless by Fonseca.
We played 4 quarters and haven't been able to find a winner. So we're going to go to overtime.
Nicholls State, you're the visiting team. It's called a toss. Heads is called. It is heads. You want defense first.
Get a lead. Put the pressure on Nicholls. 41-yard kick. Gabe Ruiz, who's hit from 54, and that is good. And Kansas scores first.
Chase 4K, Jr., New Orleans, Louisiana. He has started 23 of his 24 games in his Colonel career. Second and 11 in 4K design run. Rolls to the left, breaks to the 20, on his feet to the 15. First down, Chase 4K. All muscle, all moxie. Colonels are 14 yards away from a win. Bring the noise, Colonel fans. This is your moment. 23-20 Kansas, overtime. Second and goal for the Colonels. 4K with three receivers to the left. Bussey lined up to his right. A right hash snap. Rolling out is 4K. He tucks it. He runs.
Go, go, go!
Yeah! He's in! A Nicholls knockout! KU is KO'd by the Colonels in overtime. A 26-23 win for the Nicholls State University Colonels.
No better way to start the season for the Nicholls Colonels. They win 26-23 in overtime against Kansas. 50 years from now, Colonel fans will be talking about this game.
Yeah, I'm so happy for a lot of people. Those guys in the locker room, they worked so hard. They thought they can come in here and win. Some of them, you know where they've come from, how far they've come. And look, coaches did a great job, the administration, everybody was here, the fans, the community. Just happy for them. But, you know, you're sounding like the old coach, man, but we want to know, but we got to get back tomorrow, go to work, and get ready for the next one.
The power of positivity. We always talk about it with your program. Stay up, stay up, stay up. There was an opportunity in the fourth quarter to get negative when some things don't go your way and they get the lead. What happened when Kansas did take the 2017 lead?
Well, we have a lot of senior leadership on this team. We had a bunch of guys who didn't get down. They didn't put their head down. They said, hey, we knew what we got to do. We knew we can move the ball on them. And I guess they will find a way. The guys just came through, and a big kick by LaRon in that situation and forced it into overtime.
Nicholls holds Kansas under 100 yards of total offense in the second half, and they start 5-for-6 on third downs, but they finish 1-for-10, really a deciding factor in the game. They couldn't stop your pressure. The sacks just multiplied in the second half, and then your offense, they were ready to win it.
Yeah, look, we talked at halftime. You know, we go in 10-10. And you looked at it, and they had a few more plays than us. They had more time in possessions, then they were pretty good on third down. But we thought the defensive line at the end of half was getting in a little rhythm. They thought they could get to them a little bit. And then when you go look at it, you know, we stopped them on third down. We had the time in possession, and we had a lot more plays than them in the second half.
And overtime, you were ready for a new wrinkle from your offense. Chase 4K, why wouldn't it be number 9, winning the game, carrying the ball in his hands? Your quarterback, just the level of effort and guts he brings to the field, none of it is surprising, but what a way to walk it off.
Yeah, you know, he wants the ball in his hand every time we go and play, and we put him in that situation. We had been pounding a little bit, but they got us a couple times. You know, they blitzed us, but also that offensive line did an outstanding job just staying with it all game, staying in there.
Kendall Bussey, my goodness, 28 carries, just under 130 yards in his first game of his Colonel career. Go-ahead 40-yard touchdown. Remarkable accolades all across the board. But what a reminder of how far this program has come. That 4 years ago, your first two FBS games, 88-0 shutouts. And we mention that because you've turned the table so far in such a short period of time. How do you appreciate and celebrate something? Even though it's one game, this is such an amazing moment.
Look, tonight we always have the same rule. I'm sure we'll enjoy playing right home, but let's get back to work tomorrow, because we got to go to New Orleans next week against a hungry Tulane team who's very talented. So I'm sure, you know, we'll look back and say beating a Power 5 school when you look at it at the end of the year, but right now we got a lot of work to do.
One-way ticket home, coach.
Yeah, one way. That's what we need to do.
Tim Rebowe, Nicholls football. Different week for the Nicholls Colonels as we welcome you back to the Coach Tim Rebowe Show. Nicholls picks up the 26-23 win against Kansas, and then you fly back to New Orleans, finally get a chance to watch the game film, but you have to make a couple big adjustments going into the week. Tropical storm moving in, practice got bumped up, a lot to look at in those 24 hours after you return from Kansas.
Yeah, we like to stay to the same routine, so we got in kind of late, which is not unusual for us, but we got the film graded on Sunday when we got back.
The coaches did a good job of that. We brought our players in like normal. We lifted weights. We watched the film. We had our practice. Then we would send them to bed, hopefully get some rest. You know, with the weekend being the holiday weekend, they're all able to get a lot of rest and try to get some recovery time in.
For those of us watching a football game, it's so hard to appreciate and process everything that happens in a play. You've got 22 guys, point of attack, so much physicality. It's hard to see everything. What do you look at on the field, live action? What are you trying to monitor as a play is going down?
Well, I think every coach, you assign them to different areas. So you have coaches in a box assigned to watch certain things. You have guys on the sideline to watch another. And then you have the position coach to watch, you know, at point of impact, some of his players. So there's a lot of different things going on. But the biggest thing that we have to do, and you know, is try to make some in-game adjustments is after that play's over, you got to be ready to move on to the next one.
We always relive the game when we look at our video highlights and edit game film, and it's amazing how much you don't notice. Third and three, first quarter, first series of the game, you get a 19-yard run from Dontrell Taylor. Your offensive line was brilliant all night. But Jordan Talley, first career start at tight end, he takes two Kansas defenders down with him on a pull. Is that the joy of watching film after a game, to really note all of those accomplishments?
Well, I think so. You know, you go and you grade those guys, and they like to see themselves, and they like to see themselves do good. But, you know, you kind of know going in the offensive line was pretty good. We had a good game, you know, before even watching the film. Me and you were talking on the field after. We had some good things going on. But it's nice to see some guys that work hard and see it pay off on Saturday.
Especially when you have guys like Jair Joseph that are called into duty. Third quarter, Demetrius Clayton goes down, and Jair was involved in that 40-yard touchdown run for Kendall Bussey. It's been the same story for three-plus seasons with this offensive line. You continue to find guys to fill a need.
Yeah, and it's really in all the positions when you look at it, too. You can plug in any running back there. You throw in a receiver, but I'm proud of Jair. He's worked hard to get to this spot. He's going to help us this year.
Kevin Johnson playing the number two at nickelback. Came in for some big situations behind Imani Martin. He was involved in the forced fumble, was also involved in a big pass breakup. How many of those guys knew that they were going to be so influential in this game, their first big opportunity to play, and they delivered for you?
Well, you talk about it on Friday night. Well, you talk about it all week, and then you go over it again and say, hey, there's going to be some guys that's going to have to be some impact players in the game. You just don't know which one it's going to be. So hopefully you prepare those guys. And, you know, any athlete will tell you you have to prepare like you're going to be the starter. And those guys are prepared. Pair like that, and when their number's called, they're ready to answer it.
When they step up and do exactly what you've asked them to do, how does that change the possibility of more opportunities for their next game and for the rest of the season?
I think at any position, for any coach, it's a trust factor. You know, if you get out there and you show you can do it, and those coaches know they can trust you in those situations, but it starts in practice. You can't just say, because we always talk about the practice execution, what's going to happen in a game, and sure enough, if you do it in practice, you are going to do it in a game, and KJ is a perfect example of that. But it's also you try to tell the guys is get your plays in on special teams, and he has been a special teams guy last year. Again this year he made some fantastic plays for us. There's many more guys like him who's ready to step up and step on the field.
Trust is such an important word when it comes to special teams, and you continue to have some really dependable players that step up time and time again. Ron Fonseca, he was automatic on Saturday, and then Winston Jones, first career start at punter. His first two punts landed at the 12 and the 19-yard line. Can't ask for a better debut from him.
Yeah, he did a good job. I was proud of Winston. He hit a couple balls pretty good, and then they had a pretty good wind blowing out there, too. Yeah. So I thought he handled those situations well. I thought LaRon did a good job of kicking off into the wind. He had a couple touchbacks, and of course the field goal for 42 or 43, whatever it was into the wind. You know, we did have some disappointments on special teams. You know, you can't have a snap go over the head and miss assignment on a punt block and then drop a ball and expect to win a game. But we did have all those threes, and we still won it, so it's hats off to those guys.
Three miscues that you can correct on special teams, and the Colonels still get a win over a Big 12 opponent on the road. Now, another FBS opponent awaits Nicholls Saturday night. It's Tulane and the Colonels. We'll break down the green wave as we continue on with the Coach Tim Rebowe Show. We're back with the Coach Tim Rebowe Show with Nicholls preparing for Tulane. It's a Saturday night game at 7 p.m. ESPN3 and ESPN Radio New Orleans for game number two this season for the Colonels. It wouldn't be the month of August or September without an adjustment in your practice schedule. The weather finally playing a part in South Louisiana sports. Had to move up practice a little bit this week, a Monday practice for the Colonels. Something different, but not something unexpected for your team. They've made these adjustments in your 4 years every single year.
Well, I think every team has to go through it, especially in South Louisiana, all along the Gulf Coast. Guys got to adjust, but we talk about it as a staff. We have to learn to adjust. The players, we ask them to adjust all the time, so not a big deal for us. It is the holiday Monday, so our guys going to come in. We're going to have a night practice just to try to get a little bit ahead of the weather. To see, you don't know what it's going to do on Tuesday or Wednesday. It's supposed to be cleared out of here by Wednesday afternoon and back to a normal Thursday. So, look, preparation is in, green wave, full speed ahead. We just got to get our guys ready for it.
It's still amazing. This is the first game in the history of Tulane and Nicholls football. A lot of familiarity. All these players know one another. Willie Fritz, he has a long history of success in the Southland from his days with Sam Houston State. Really impressive loss to open the season for Tulane. They lose in overtime to Wake Forest, but Jonathan Banks has 18 completions for 281 yards. A lot of explosive players on this roster.
Yeah, first of all, Willie Fritz does a great job. His staff, I mean, we've become over the last couple of years real close with those guys. We know a bunch of them. A lot of guys in his staff was in the Southland Conference years ago, so we've been knowing them. I think they've done an outstanding job of recruiting and getting the right players in over there, and he's got them playing at a high level. They were, one play away last year from going to a bowl game. Yeah. Fluke play, and you know how those go. So he's got a real good football team. It starts with the quarterback, and he's under center. And look, I know what they want to do offensively, and they're going to try to control that ball and move the ball on us, and he's got a tremendous set of skilled athletes. So our defense is going to have a tough task this week.
They have one of the best receivers in the AAC, and Taron Onkelad. Do you bring back Taron's brother, Terrell, as an honorary coach this week for the Colonels? He spent 2 years as a great defensive end for you. Come on, Terrell, give us some hints.
Well, we told him this, man. He's got to stay away from over there. He's got to stay over here. We don't know where his loyalty's going to lie.
It's amazing how much connection exists in the game of college football, and we're reminded it's a small world time and time again. 8 Louisianans on Kansas's roster, and then this Tulane team, as we mentioned, everybody knows one another. How will familiarity play a part in this game?
Well, big. I mean, those guys read about Tulane all the time. They played against each other. They know some of our players. I mean, you get during the season and everybody has their own things going on, but those guys read. They read. It's with social media now. They keep up with them. So they know they got a lot of good players on that team.
It really felt like a natural transition for your team after the win against Kansas. You didn't have to tell them to, hey, 24 hours, we've got a big game next week. They were ready to pivot and prepare for Tulane almost the second they boarded that plane in Kansas City.
Well, you got to think that way. You got to have that mindset. And I know every coach will tell you and try to get it across to that team that you got to do that. It's one game. It's a one-game season every week. After we play Tulane, we got to turn our attention to the next one. You can't look too far ahead of yourself. But that's how you got to approach it. So I know our guys will be ready.
How did some of those close losses and previous FBS matchups prepare your team to move on, appreciate the win, but to not obsess over accomplishing something that isn't their season-long goal? They have much bigger ambitions with this year.
I think anytime you play a game like we played over the last couple of years, not just against FBS opponents, all of our games, we've had some close games, and you learn how to win those, and you got to come through. It's still always a learning process, and I think our guys have done that. We've been in some close games, so when we got into that overtime game, we talked about it on the sideline. We've been here before. We knew what to expect, and I think that's why we had a little success.
It really does feel like a team that is meant to win close games, to play close games, but to finish those close games. You've had a lot of opportunities in your 4 years here, and that was the difference in a 7-win conference season last year. It was the difference in week one in 2018. What is it about that mindset of knowing the games are going to be close, but that favors the Colonels?
Well, I don't know. You try to practice that way. You try to drill it in everybody's head that we can do it. That you always want to say play for four quarters. Yeah. We talk about that.
We win this thing. We win the game. Let's win the four quarters.
Come in on three. 1, 2, 3. Come in.
And our guys believe that when they step on the field, they can play. And you want to think about, too, you're never out of any game. So you always have that. It's just one play at a time, get in the fourth quarter, and try to pull it out.
So much of the last 4 years has been about creating credibility, generating interest, and then legitimizing it. You are now the number 10 team in FCS. You sweep the All-Conference awards from the Southland Conference. Plenty of media attention, a lot of publicity. It doesn't seem like it's too much for these guys.
Well, you hope not. Look, those guys deserve recognition. LaRon, you know, kicking the game tying field goal, and what Sully did on the defensive line. And then, you know, newcomer Kendall Bussey to the league, he really had a good game. But those guys know it takes everybody. It takes everybody on the team. We talk about it. The biggest headline was that the Colonels won, and our guys know that. So we just got to keep moving forward. It's good to get the recognition. But, you know, you talk about being ranked, and our guys know this too. It's not where you are right now. It's improving every week, and we still got to get better at a lot of things. And hopefully we can be ranked somewhere near the end of the year.
120 yards rushing in Kendall Bussey's debut, and Sully Lesh, 4 tackles for a loss. He gets 2 sacks in the win. Now it's all about Tulane, and what will be the difference in this game between the Green Wave and Colonels?
Well, I think this, you know, offensively, we got our hands full too. We talked about defensively, but defensively, they can really run and they get after you. Their secondary is as physical as anybody we're going to ever play. Their linebackers can really hit you, and they do an outstanding job. So I think it's going to be the same thing. We got to be able to try to run the football. We got to be able to control the football. And if we can do like last week and limit turnovers, you know, offensively, we didn't have any, then I think we can have a chance. On that side of the ball. Defensively, we got to contain them a little bit. I mean, they're going to have some big play potentials. You talk about the receivers and the running backs. But if we run to the ball and, you know, be assignment sound, then hopefully you can be successful.
You can check out the Colonels Saturday night in New Orleans. They're playing at Yeoman Stadium for the first time in program history. 7 p.m. kickoff on ESPN Radio New Orleans. And we're back next week for the Coach Tim Rebowe Show on your home for Colonel Sports, HTV.